Hey everyone, it's Christine from Christine Peace, and I'm going to continue my series on non-violent protest. I think the topic I'm covering today is a very interesting one, and I hope that you do watch the whole video because I think it's worth it anyway. I'm going to butcher this word. It's a Russian word, but it's called Samizdat, S-A-M-I-Z-D-A-T. It was a key form of dissident activity in the Soviet bloc. Yes, the Soviet bloc doesn't exist anymore, and most of you here on YouTube were alive when it did exist, but I was fortunate enough to be alive for the end of the Soviet bloc. I got to watch basically the Berlin Wall come down. I was fortunate enough to see people standing on the wall, dancing, singing, embracing, drinking, and toasting to the end of their oppression and finally being free. The end of the Soviet bloc and the Berlin Wall coming down meant the reunion of people and loved ones that hadn't seen each other since the end of the Second World War, if you can imagine. So it has a great spot in our human line or history, and I was so fortunate to see it live, to see it happening on television. I wish I could have been there. But back to one of the forms, the form that I'll be coming today on nonviolent resistance, Samizdat. It is a nonviolent method, and it did help bring the Soviet Union to its knees. And yes, I have notes because I don't want to miss anything. This is important. Okay, so what is Samizdat? People across the Soviet bloc were reproducing censored material, books, and other publications by hand. Okay, one of the Soviet's favorite methods for oppressing its people was the denial of information and the spread of their own ideas about the truth to people, to keep the people oppressed. And there were people in the Soviet bloc that had no idea what was going on outside of their own home, and anything that they did find out about the world was usually a censored interpretation spread by the government. And you know, if they didn't know it, most did. And really not a pleasant way to live. Censorship to a lot of people within the community of free thinkers is an important thing to have. It should be a right for everyone. And I'm not going to get into why, because most of us understand its depth and its importance anyway. So the reproduction of publications was strictly banned. People had no idea what was going on outside of their own homes, like I said. It was extremely dangerous and took a lot of bravery. A lot more bravery than breaking into a Foot Locker and stealing some shoes. And I'll get into why it took bravery in a minute. Reproductions were often passed hand to hand, and even people that you'd known for years since you were a kid, even family members were a danger to you sometimes and could turn you in for a myriad of reasons, some of which were pressured into it, some just for personal gain. But I'm not going to get into why the people were betraying each other in the Soviet Union, because it's not something you can cover really, on top of covering this topic as well in one video. Where was I? Why was it so important to make sure that things were copied and passed on and information was brought to the masses? Well, information is power. I think most of us have heard that saying before, and a good way of emphasizing how powerful it is the fact that censorship was in use at all, because if it weren't power, we wouldn't see censorship. Techniques for reproducing were various types of different methods were used, including carbon paper, typewriters, using printers at night while on the night shift, using semi-professional printing presses printing presses that people made from scratch at home, or printing presses in companies that didn't know you were using them. All of which were very dangerous because copy machines, printing processors, and even typewriters in offices were under the control of the First Department or KGB. Printouts from all of these were stored for the examination and identification process by the KGB or secret police. Although they weren't very secret, they were very well known and very feared in the Soviet Union because the secret police could take people and you would never see them again. That's how scary it was. They were not trusted by the average person, and rightly so. And for people who were caught in the possession of censored materials or the materials used to make these copies, they were lucky to go to prison and only go to prison. Most were interrogated, tortured, for the names of their friends and associates that were involved in the process of spreading censored material and copying censored material. And under torture, you will break. It just depends on how long it takes individuals. Even family members and friends that were not involved in the process were often arrested and used against you, tortured themselves, threatened by the KGB so that you would break, sent to jail just because they were associated with you. Guilt by association, anyone? Some people just disappeared and never were heard from again. A very scary prospect or idea. The Soviet bloc was not the only place that used this method. There are many other countries and times in history where people did copy censored material and pass it out. But this is the one I wanted to focus on because it's the probably the newest and most well-known example. Samizdat was incredibly dangerous, but some would say it was incredibly important. It did help bring the Soviet bloc to its end and is a great example of a non-violent use of resistance and protest. I hope you enjoyed this information and learned something. My next video will be on non-violent resistance, the use of music, poetry, and art. That should be a really good one. And if you want to get in the mood, listen to any music from the 60s, basically. Every song you've heard from the 60s, and even the ones you haven't heard, were basically resistance songs or protest songs in some way, shape, or form, and to some degree. I would also like to take this time to thank Serious Minded. I will put his link in the crotch bar below. He was vigilant in the defending of my ideas and opinions in some of my recent videos on the riots. Thank you for understanding what my point was and trying to help others understand. I would also like to thank, and of course my phone rings, TattooSkin72, who I'll also link in the bar below, because he was not only outspoken in the comments, but also in video form as well. Thank you for my support, brother, and I will catch you guys soon with the music of the resistance. Cheers in his own.